Okay, Adlimelech, your request for burgers, for how we used to make it and also how I make it nowadays, I'm going to show you today. However, I'm going to split it up into three parts. One is the meat, then the patty, then everything around it. So regarding your request for the rib sauce, I'm not going to embarrass myself there because your brother Morne has overtaken me on that recipe a long time ago. But trying to get that recipe from him is like trying to get clarity on our current lockdown situation. So it's not going to happen anytime soon. Maybe I'm getting to do a video with me sometime. Anyway, back to the meat and the patty. It's not necessarily just walking to your supermarket, grabbing mince off the shelf. You need to put a little bit more thought into it. So I normally have the suppliers that we used to use in the restaurants that I've relied on over the years. And Delico is by far the most consistent regarding mince when I buy mince for burgers. Now I'm going to just take out what I've got here. So, like I said, there are two options here, or options that you can do, and that is buying the ready-made mince. And then, also, if you want to do a little bit of extra, we're going to make our own mince for burgers. So, but regardless of whether you're making your own mince or if you buy ready-made mince, the key factor here is to remember to have the equal ratios of meat and fat. Now, just to buy lean mince, it's probably not going to give you a good burger. But the ratio you're always looking for is about 80% meat and 20% of... sorry, I was adding my music, so I probably need to get skipped somewhere. Anyway, so 20% fat, 80% meat ratio. So obviously your butcher, you can ask your butcher for that. When you ask your butcher, normally when they make burger mince or beef mince in general, they take the fore-quarter of the beef and you're using either brisket or chuck, but they're also putting extra, like, you know, offcuts from fillet or rump or whatever offcuts they've got, and they'll either make a sausage from that or beef mince. But if you go to your butcher, you can ask specifically what you want. Now, like I said before, Delico has been consistently a good supplier over the years that we've used. Other people that we've had really good mince. Now again, it depends on what you want. Now this is just regular beef, but I really enjoy grass-fed beef, and for that, Ryan Boone Butchery, Usana Vineyards have fantastic meat. So if you're buying ready-made mince, what I normally want to do before I make the burger is I want to get a colander so I can drain any blood or moisture from the meat. Of course, we're going to make the patties in two different ways. I'm going to just, with the ready-made mince, we're going to add some stuff to it. And you also want to make sure that you check your moisture content. So I'm just going to add this into the colander quickly. Put that music a little softer, but I need some music today. So I'm just going to cut this open. And start the plastic, which we'll take care of in a bit. So when you're looking at this, there's always things to remember. Whenever you buy meat that's been vacuum sealed, there's always going to be a bit of blood in it. And often when you buy steaks or mince that's been vacuum sealed, because you need to understand there's a process here that they call either dry age or wet age. Now when you wet age something or you vacuum seal it, and that's when they do wet aging, when you open it up, there's always going to be a bit of a smell. So don't, especially when you're buying steak or meat, and you open the packet up and there's a bit of a smell, that's just blood. Don't just think, oh, the meat's off. Always give it about 20 minutes or so to breathe and get some air before you make a decision on that. You'll also notice that there's a bit of a brownish color sometimes when it's vacuum sealed, but also after that, you'll see that the redness in the meat will actually come back to it. Now, when I'm just going to grab some hand sanitizer and clean my hands. It's not a COVID thing. It is just pure hygiene that we've, you know, that you always consider, especially when you're working with raw meats, whether it's beef, chicken, lamb, doesn't matter, because you want to make sure that you protect the meat from your bacteria. So I'm just going to be back in a second. Okay, so good, the alcohol rub is good to evaporate. But make sure that it's evaporated properly before you work with the meat again, because the last thing you want is your burger to taste like it should be. So while my hands are drying off, I'm just going to open up this piece of steak here. Now, when you're choosing to meat for your, if you want to make patties yourself, you can obviously ask your butcher for brisket or anything like that. Now, like I said, I really enjoy grass-fed beef. Now, this is, I'm going to try something different. I haven't used this kind of meat before. Now, this is a dry-aged meat. Now, so the process, when you look it up, Google it, whatever. So it's a dry-aged meat, and I really enjoy the flavors that I get from it. And that's why this patty, we also, after we made the mince, we're going to make this patty in another way, that obviously I'll explain into video number two. So I'm just going to open this up a little bit so I can just get this. Now, what I really want you to look at, now we've talked about when you're buying mince, having a good fat ratio of 20% fat to 80% beef. Now, when you're considering the steak, you'll notice that what we call, and you probably know this, is marbling. Now, the marbling is the fat in between the meat. Now, how are you going to weigh this up? So here you're going to have to, you know, have a look a little bit. I'm going to trim this off because obviously there's sinew and stuff in a bit, so I'm going to cut this off in a little bit. But it's, you know, that's why rump better for brine on the fire. Or, but I'm really going to give this a try today. I'm very keen on just that dry aged flavor of the beef. Okay. So, just coming back to our ready-made mince. Now, before I pop this in the fridge, now again, when making the patties, which I'll discuss in video two again, it's extremely important that you make sure that you handle the meat as little as possible. There is science to making your burger patty and when you're using the mince. But I'm just going to quickly just separate this a little bit, just so that all the blood and everything can drain from it. And then I'm going to pop this back into the fridge. And again, before you touch anything else, wash your hands. You've got blood all over the place. So, that is going back in there. Okay, so like I said, fat percentage. Now, because I wasn't 100% sure how much fat I'm going to be able to cut off, how much beef and how much fat I'm going to get off, I've just asked the butcher for extra offcuts of beef mince, of beef fat. So they can provide this for you, and it's dirt cheap to buy, you know. So, but I'm going to just quickly cut this up, and I'm going to get back to you pretty soon. Just another handy tip, whenever you work in the kitchen or you have to cut something else, using a damp cloth underneath your chopping board is good, because then slipping off the board. Then crucial is to have a nice sharp knife. Now this one actually still traveled me from the UK, and I bought this about 12 years ago and it's still with me. And another handy kitchen tool to have is probably a good kitchen a knife sharpener. Now this is a V-Sharp Classic 2. The back here says Carlu Tractors. No farmers, no food. True story. Okay, now I've already sharpened my knife, and I'm going to get cracking on this, and I'll see you soon.
Oh, have a dollar. In fact, no, brother man, here, have two. $2 means a snack for me, but it means a big deal to you. Be strong, serve God only. Know that if you do, beautiful heaven awaits.
Okay, so of course there's going to be some people that probably want to butcher me for cutting up a good piece of steak like this and not frying it. But then if you really think about it, a good burger patty is, well, just another form of really good steak. So that's why the quality of the meat that you put in is really, really important. Now, also before, if you're making your own mince and own one, I have to stress that it is absolutely not necessarily a cheaper way of making burgers, because the only thing is that you do have control of what actually goes into your patty, so you know that. Okay, so sorry, my phone got caught off there while I was filming, but talking to last time. So yes, it's not a cheaper way, but you've got full control of what goes into your burger and what mince you buy or meat you buy, where you buy it from, and I think sourcing the correct meat is very, very important. But that's a different topic for another day. Anyway, so I'm busy babysitting as well. Emily is sleeping. Anyway, so just to give you an idea, originally that piece of steak was 1.077 kgs, and I've now chopped up the steak into quite manageable pieces. So I'm just going to weigh that off, give you an idea of how much. Oh, this is not so manageable, so I'm just going to cut that also. So these are sinew, a little pieces that I've cut out of the meat. You want to try and obviously save as much as possible. So what I've got out is 850 grams of beef mince. Now, one of the reasons why I say it's important to get the sinew off, if you're lucky enough to buy a 5 gram mincer, fantastic, but I've got one of these old school ones. Now, with the old school ones, there's something that's important. When you're using, like I mentioned before, temperature is crucial. Now, because I've been working with this meat for with my hands for a little bit, I'm gonna pop this back into the fridge. So the steak or the fat content that now is gonna come with the meat, that is about roughly 160, 170 grams of fat that needs to go in. But like I mentioned before, you'll notice that inside the meat there's already, because I'm using the rump, that's normally got a lot of marble inside that I've reduced. This is only about 160 grams, so it's less 10 grams. I mean, I'm not a mathematician or an exact scientist. This is just a guesstimate. So I'm just going to pop that in the fridge. Then, now, the last time I used this, I wasn't as careful as I should have. Now, what has happened with the front piece? It's got a little bit of rust on it, because the best thing after you've used it and you've cleaned it and washed it, dry it off immediately so that you can then rub a little bit of olive oil on it to it, just to make sure that it prevents any rust forming. However, if a little bit of rust do get onto it, it's not an issue. I've just popped it in here into a little bit of apple cider vinegar, and let it soak there for a couple of minutes, or like 10-15 minutes, so it's still busy soaking. I'm going to put that aside and I'm going to clean that just now, and what I'm going to do with this and the rest of this, I'm actually going to put this in the freezer to make sure that that's also really cold. Okay, so I'm going to give this to, you know, when they make whiskey, they always talk about the angel share. Now I'm going to give it to me, my little angels, Hazel and Shy. They're waiting outside anxiously for this stuff. And then I'm going to clean that. And I don't need you to see the whole process. I mean, just a little bit of steel wool, scores, I don't know, what do you call this? And I'll be back. Okay, so I've just cleaned up everything a little bit, making sure everything is nice. But just to give you an idea, okay, so wasn't lying. Apple cider vinegar does a really good job I'm pinning this. No wonder it's so good for weight loss as well. Anyway, so this doesn't need to go into the fridge for that long. I need to make sure it's nice and chilled. You're not exactly trying to create a new ice age. But regarding the mechanics of this, I just want to show you quite an important part, because it sounds very stupid, but I've actually made this mistake a couple of times. So when you're putting the actual cutter, what do you call this propeller thing? Anyway, so these are the blades that's cutting the meat up. Now you actually want this to grind against the little holy part. I've done it like this before, which means now the meat and everything gets stuck in between. It doesn't work. Okay, so that's what you put in first. Make sure that it's flat against flat. Put that on there, and you just screw that one. Okay, now why everything needs to be cold and the meat needs to be cold, it just helps if the fat is too warm, you know, it's difficult to mince. But how important is why it's important for the patty, I'll explain to you when we're actually making the different patties. So I'm just going to mince these up a little bit. This is a bit too tight. Just a bit. Yeah, okay, so that's easy. And I'm just going to grind away. Probably need to focus here so I don't cut up my fingers, so I'm going to just mince this and not talk to you for a little.
Oh, cinnamon, where you going to run to? Cinnamon, where you going to run to? Where you going to run to? All on that day, will I run to the rock? Please hide me and run to the rock. Please hide me and run to the rock. Please hide me, Lord, all on that day. But the rock cried out, I can't hide you, the rock cried out. I can't hide you, the rock cried out. I ain't gonna hide you, God, all on that day. I said, rock, what's the matter with you?
So just mix everything a little bit together, not too much. Like I said, we want to keep it cold. So this is going to go back into the fridge. You catch my breath, because that's probably the closest I'll ever get to the gym. But yeah, cool. There we go. So why the temperature is important, what effect does it have on the patty, etc. We'll discuss in the next video, when we actually make the different patties. But that's the meats. Meat the meats.
Don't you see?